Charon, the largest moon compared to the size of the mother planet. Pluto and Charon were revealed by the New Horizons probe as two of the most fascinating objects in the outer solar system, and let the hardcore planetary scientists, the sky bureaucrats, say what they will. They will never succeed in making Pluto just one of the many trans-Neptunian objects orbiting in the Kuiper belt. Especially now, after the flyby by the American probe showed the world that this so-called dwarf planet is not just a simple snowball, but a real world, with mountain ranges, plains, and even an atmosphere. With an incredible bonus, the presence of the largest moon in the solar system relative to the size of its parent planet. And this is exactly what we want to talk about in this video. The uniqueness and beauty of the Pluto-Charon system, the most compact and gravitationally bound in our entire planetary system, and with a secret yet to be revealed. Did these two objects meet by chance, or was Charon born from a piece of Pluto? Imagine finding yourself on a distant, dark world where, even during the day, the light is so dim that it creates a cold and eerie landscape. Shadows are faint yet very dark. Contrasts are weak. The sky is black with stars visible both day and night, and the horizon is always blurred by a thin haze. The sun is a bright point far away, tens of thousands of times weaker than the one that warms the Earth. The region where you've landed is a vast plain covered in frozen nitrogen, dotted here and there with hills made of much harder water ice. On this world, the tallest mountains, reaching up to a few thousand meters, a few miles, are not covered in ice but are made of water ice, which at minus 230 degrees Celsius or minus 382 degrees Fahrenheit is as hard as rock. These icy monsters with steep walls and full of crevices might seem firmly anchored to the ground, yet they are not. In a vast plain covered by a fragile layer of frozen nitrogen, hills of water ice float on it and slowly move from one point to another on the planet. What a strange world, right? But there's still something else to marvel at. Just look up and be captivated by the bright disk hanging in the sky, seven times larger than how we see the moon from Earth. An eye that neither rises nor sets, always immobile in the same spot. These worlds, as you might have guessed, are Pluto and Charon. But let's take a step back and go back in time to when, for Earth-based observers, Pluto was nothing more than a dot of light, known only for its distance from the Sun, its orbital period, and its peculiarity of having the most elliptical orbit of all the planets. Its diameter was still unknown. Its mass was still a mystery. The first significant progress in understanding Pluto's physical nature was made in 1976, thanks to the first infrared observations. The spectroscopic data obtained at these wavelengths revealed the presence of numerous surface ices, including unmistakable signs of methane. From these observations, it was possible to obtain the first realistic model of Pluto, a small, icy body with a highly reflective surface. Trivial compared to what would be discovered just 2 years later. The most significant step forward in understanding what was still considered the ninth planet of the solar system came in 1978, when James Christie and Robert Harrington, analyzing a series of photographic plates obtained at the Flagstaff Observatory, discovered that Pluto had a satellite, later named Charon. Charon is an object that, even under the best observation conditions, appears separated from Pluto by just one arc second, which at Pluto's distance corresponds to a Pluto-Charon distance of about 20,000 kilometers, about 12,427 miles. Distinguishing the two objects would be like distinguishing two fireflies 20 millimeters or 0.79 inches apart from a distance of 4 kilometers or 2.49 miles. In the past, in old photographic plates collected in the archives of various observatories, it had been noted that the image of the planet, or rather the so-called confusion circle, often appeared slightly elongated. However, no one had understood the true meaning of this asymmetry, erroneously attributed to the turbulence of the Earth's atmosphere. The realization that the elongation was due to the presence of a satellite almost overlapping the planet's image came when Christie and Harrington realized that this deformation varied regularly with a period of 6.4 days, the same as the planet's rotation. Without this discovery, our knowledge of Pluto until the advent of the Hubble Space Telescope would not have progressed much. From Charon's orbital period around Pluto, which precisely matches Pluto's rotation period, and the distance between the two bodies, it was possible to determine the total mass of the system, which turned out to be much lower than previous estimates, all based on the presumed perturbations caused on Neptune's motion. Measurements of Charon also became more refined, and today we know that Charon's diameter is 1,212 kilometers, or 753 miles. Just over half that of Pluto, larger than the dwarf planet Ceres. It is the 12th largest natural satellite in the solar system. But evidently, for planetary scientists, size matters. And even though New Horizons later revealed that Pluto is not a very large asteroid, but an enigmatic world with towering mountains, vast plains, an atmosphere, and a climate, in 2006, it was downgraded to the status of a dwarf planet. However, there is one title that no one can ever take away from it. Pluto and its large moon Charon have a characteristic shared, to a lesser extent, only by one other pair, Earth and the Moon. Which one? Well, in the rest of the solar system, the mass of satellites is negligible compared to that of the planet they orbit, with a ratio never exceeding 1/4,000th. Think of the voluminous satellites of Jupiter compared to the enormity of their parent planet. Our Moon and Charon, on the other hand, are out of scale compared to other satellites. The Moon has a mass equal to 1/81 of that of Earth, and Charon reaches up to 1/8 of Pluto's mass. When a planet has a mass thousands of times greater than that of its satellites, they orbit it without significantly disturbing its motion. But if hypothetically, the planet and satellite have the same mass, the center of mass would fall exactly halfway between the two objects. None of Jupiter's large satellites, for example, manage to appreciably attract the gas giant towards themselves, while Earth and Pluto are forced by the relatively large mass of the Moon and Charon to rotate around a center of mass somewhat distant from their geometric center. In the case of the Earth-Moon pair, the common center of mass is still within the Earth, 4,700 kilometers or 2,920 miles from the planet's geometric center, and about 1,500 kilometers or 932 miles from the surface. In the case of Pluto and Charon, however, the center of mass is in space between the two bodies, approximately 950 kilometers or 590 miles above Pluto's surface. And it is precisely this fact that allows the Pluto-Charon pair to be called binary. The most accepted definition for the term binary or double planet seems to be that the center of mass of the pair must be outside the more massive body. Using this test, Pluto and Charon are a double planet, while Earth and the Moon are not, albeit by a small margin. Hey guys, just a moment before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you'll help us to make products of even higher quality. Additionally, there is another peculiarity. Charon not only always shows the same face to Pluto as the Moon does to Earth, but it is also the only satellite in the solar system that keeps the planet in a state of synchronization between rotation and orbital motion. This means that Pluto always shows the same face to Charon. In other words, if you could stretch a nearly 20,000 kilometer or 12,427 mile long string from Pluto to Charon, it would remain taut, and in theory you could use it to travel from one body to the other. Consequences? Well, definitely. The hypothetical inhabitants of Charon's visible side would see Pluto looming in their sky with an angular diameter of 7.3 degrees, 15 times that of the full moon seen from Earth. Charon, on the other hand, with a diameter of 1,200 kilometers or 746 miles, would appear in Pluto's sky with an angular diameter of 3.7 degrees, about 7 times that of the full moon. This would allow those unlikely creatures to distinctly see Charon's surface features with the naked eye from Pluto, and vice versa, even though the entire landscape would appear bathed in more than twilight light due to the great distance from the Sun. Pluto and Charon follow a very elliptical orbit, which they complete in 248 Earth years. Their distance from the Sun can therefore vary between 4.4 billion kilometers, or 2.7 billion miles at perihelion, and the abyss of over 7.3 billion kilometers, or 4.5 billion miles at aphelion. At such enormous distances, the Sun appears tiny, on average just over one arc minute at perihelion, 1/30th of its apparent size in the Earth's sky, and 35 arc seconds at aphelion. It would look like a pinpoint of blinding light. The amount of light and heat received by a planet primarily depends on its distance from the Sun. The farther it is, the less light and heat it receives. But the dependence is quadratic, meaning that doubling the distance reduces the irradiation by 4 times. Pluto is on average 40 times farther from the Sun than Earth is. That means that from Pluto, the Sun appears 40 times 40 equals 1600th times fainter, or to use better math grammar, 1/1600th as bright as from our fairer, more familiar world. That's a big drop. But how faint is that really? In our sky, the Sun is about 400,000 times brighter than the full moon. That means that from Pluto, the Sun would still be 250 times brighter than the full moon as seen from Earth. Mind you, the full moon is easily bright enough to read by, so even from distant Pluto, the Sun would illuminate the landscape pretty well, at about the same level as twilight on Earth. But the face-to-face gravitational embrace leads to another consequence. From Charon's far hemisphere, Pluto would never be observable, just as the inhabitants of Pluto's far hemisphere would never see Charon in their sky. Sure, this is what happens on the far side of our moon, but not for us on Earth. Just imagine for a moment if Earth were also locked in a face-to-face with the moon, and only one hemisphere had the privilege of always having it in the sky. It would create an incredible tourist flow, and perhaps even spiritual pilgrimages. However, if you were already thinking about it for a romantic vacation, Charon is unobservable from Sputnik Planitia, the heart-shaped plane that immediately captured the public's attention. From the first images, it was already clear that its surface must have undergone significant geological processes, as evidenced by areas with very few impact craters and a very smooth appearance. A high-resolution image was enough to confirm this definitively. Icy mountains up to 3,500 meters or 11,483 feet high that do not appear to be more than 100 million years old. Mountains composed mainly of water ice, as other materials like methane are not hard enough to rise to such heights. Water ice, on the other hand, behaves exactly like solid rock at these temperatures. 100 million years, when dinosaurs still roamed our Earth, a mere blip in time that makes us realize that this celestial body is probably still active. Something very similar to what happens on Triton and Enceladus, on Io and Europa, and of course, Titan. Here, however, we are much farther from the Sun, and many parameters are different. One in particular is truly important. Pluto's not a satellite of a giant planet, and the heating of its interior cannot be due to the usual tidal effects, more or less related to resonances. Other processes are necessary, considering that radioactive decay cannot be the sole cause given its small size. Perhaps, but it's still just an idea, its giant moon so close could play a decisive role. Charon also seems to hide a complex geological history. Its entire surface appears recent, as evidenced by the scarcity of craters. Its chemical composition also seems to differ from that of its larger sibling, water rather than methane and carbon monoxide, a difference that could help us understand their different geological evolutions. Let's remember that Charon is heavily influenced by the companion's gravity, and perhaps shares part of its atmosphere, as it seems almost certain that the reddish coloration of its north pole is due to a migration of organic sediments from Pluto. Charon also has an extensive system of grabens and scarps, like Serenity Chasma, which extend like an equatorial belt for at least 1,000 kilometers, or 620 miles. Argo Chasma potentially reaches a depth of 9 kilometers, or 6 miles, with cliffs that could rival Verona Rupes on Miranda for the title of the highest cliff in the solar system. Okay, some of you might say, Pluto and Charon are quite a pair, especially very close. But here are the same questions arise that have tormented all terrestrial planetary scientists for decades about Earth and the Moon. Namely, what is the origin of this extraordinary bond? Several scenarios have been examined to explain the origin of the Pluto-Charon binary system, including a common origin by accretion from the material that composed the protoplanetary nebula, mutual capture following an impact between proto-Pluto and proto-Charon, and finally a fission process caused by the high rotational speed of young Pluto. The hypothesis of gravitational capture without physical contact is not acceptable from a dynamic point of view. Formation following a collapse involving a small part of the protoplanetary nebula is also unrealistic due to the small size of the two objects. The standard theory of planetary formation suggests that bodies as large as Pluto and Charon must have formed by accretion of macroscopic bodies like planetesimals. Similarly, the rotational fission hypothesis is likely to be discarded because the Pluto-Charon system has too much angular momentum per unit mass to have once been a single body. The most plausible explanation for the origin of the Pluto-Charon binary system is therefore the collision of two planetary bodies, Pluto and another large Kuiper belt object, a scenario similar to that proposed for the origin of our Moon. According to this model, Pluto and the object that struck it formed independently of each other by accumulating small planetesimals and subsequently collided, dissipating enough energy to allow the formation of a binary system. An important difference between the giant impacts that gave rise to the Pluto-Charon and Earth-Moon systems is that the relative collision velocities, and therefore the impact energies, in the case of Pluto and Charon, were much lower. This considerably reduced the thermal consequences of the collision. So, while Earth may have been largely melted by the impact of an object the size of Mars, necessary to create a body like the Moon, the object from whose collision Charon would have formed would have increased Pluto's temperature by only 50 degrees Celsius to 60 degrees Celsius, 122 degrees Fahrenheit to 140 degrees Fahrenheit. This could still have been enough to cause internal differentiation of the two bodies and produce a substantial, relatively warm atmosphere that would have quickly dispersed into space, interacting with the impact fragments orbiting Pluto from which Charon would have formed. Such a phenomena, among other things, would also justify the high rock content, about 70%, that seemed to characterize Pluto's internal composition, which is much greater than that of other icy bodies, like most of the satellites of the giant planets. Although this scenario for the formation of the Pluto-Charon system currently enjoys the most support, it is worth noting that no realistic simulation has yet been developed to reproduce the event. The fact remains that the giant impact hypothesis is the only one capable of satisfying most of the dynamic and physical constraints, particularly the high specific angular momentum of the binary system and the high obliquity of the rotation axis, 120 degrees, relative to the orbital plane around the Sun, as well as explaining the existence of the other four small moons that complete Pluto's system. The four small moons orbit Pluto at 2 to 4 times Charon's distance, from Styx, 42,700 kilometers, or 26,540 miles, to Hydra's, 64,800 kilometers, 40,260 miles, from the system's barycenter. They have prograde, nearly circular orbits on the same orbital plane as Charon. These four satellites are much smaller than Charon. Nix and Hydra have diameters of about 42 and 55 kilometers, 26 and 34 miles respectively, while Styx and Kerberos are 7 and 12 kilometers, 4 and 7 miles respectively. All four are irregularly shaped and in resonance with Charon, with orbital periods of 3, 4, 5, and 6 times for Styx, Nix, Kerberos, and Hydra, respectively. As mentioned earlier, their presence supports the giant impact hypothesis, capable of stripping enough material from Pluto to also give rise to their formation in addition to Charon's. However, there are some doubts that the formation of the satellites could have occurred due to a single impact event, given the color differences between Pluto and Nix, which are reddish, and Charon and Hydra, which are grayish. More recent work suggests, however, that the impact thesis needs modifying. The problem is, although the icy nature of Charon relative to Pluto should be a consequence of the hypothesis, further assessment indicated that the difference should be even more marked than it appears to be. In other words, Pluto should be even rockier and Charon even less rocky than they are. The newer, modified impact hypothesis postulates that Charon itself was the impacting body, not the result of accretion of debris following a strike by a third object. According to this hypothesis, Charon and Pluto were initially unrelated Kuiper belt objects, but at some time in the distant past, Charon literally bumped into Pluto in a very low velocity collision that was nevertheless sufficient to deplete the former of most of the very volatile ices that presumably coated its surface. Yet, the impact was insufficiently violent to shatter either body. Following this gentle impact, the two bodies assumed orbit around a common center of gravity, and the Pluto-Charon pair was born. Such a scenario appears to be in agreement with the previously noted discovery that large Kuiper belt objects are more likely to have moons than smaller ones. The larger objects should be better at holding onto bodies that nudge into them at low relative velocity. Perhaps both scenarios are at work among Kuiper belt objects. But these are ultimately trivialities. The important thing is to know that billions of kilometers away from us, a binary system moves lazily, even more fascinating and mysterious than the one we currently live in. At least, that's our opinion. What's yours?